Welcome to the Calandra Institute. My name is Rosangela Bricheza. I'm the Assistant Director for Academic and Cultural Programs here at the Calandra Institute. And tonight we are presenting an event that is part of our Philip V. Canestraro Seminar Series in Italian American Studies. We are very excited to have Elizabeth Zanoni here presenting her book, Migrant Marketplaces, Food and Italians in North and South America, which was published by the University of Illinois Press this year. I'd now like to introduce the Dean of the Institute, Anthony Tamburi.
I'm delighted that Elizabeth is here. Elizabeth and I were on a panel a couple of years ago in Venice. We were fortunate enough to have been invited with a couple of other scholars from North America. And I just wanted to say that I just love this cover because I love that oil can. We all grew up with those oil cans. And when I saw it, I immediately harked back to my childhood when, you know, we used to take those cans and we used to actually have to open them up with a can opener as opposed to the pop now.
Elizabeth Zanoni is Associate Professor of History at Old Dominion University in Norfolk, Virginia. Her work on gender, migration, and consumption has appeared in the Journal of American Ethnic History, Social Science History, and a number of edited collections, including Joseph Shora and Laura Ruberto's New Italian Migrations to the United States, which was published by the University of Illinois Press in 2017. Her book, Migrant Marketplaces, Food and Italians in North and South America, published by the University of Illinois Press this year, tackles questions about how migrants form identities and culinary practices around foods from their homelands, and how, in turn, migrant food cultures transform global trade routes. She also served as guest editor of the Migrant Marketplace special issue of Global Food History, published January of this year, whose contributions consider the consequences of links between migration and trade on the evolution of migrant cuisines. Please welcome Elizabeth Zanoni.
Good evening, everyone. How's everyone doing? Good? Great. Okay. I want to begin by thanking the Calandra Institute for the invitation to talk with you tonight about my book, especially Rosangela, Joe, and Anthony. I've had the good fortune of attending many Calandra events where I have presented actually parts of this larger book project, and every time I'm here, I walk away with insights that have improved my research. I also actually want to recognize my uncle, Charles Zanoni. Can you put your hand up? Yay. Okay, thanks. So my uncle Charlie has served migrant and refugee communities for over 50 years as a Scalabrinian priest, including as pastor of the Church of Our Lady of Pompeii in Greenwich Village during the 1980s, where he is currently retired as a much-deserved retiree after serving migrant communities in many different cities in Canada and the United States. So it's a real honor to have you here tonight. Thanks. Okay, so I want to start with an advertisement. This is an advertisement for Pinerol brand liqueur, an Argentine aperitivo manufactured by the Pini brothers, Italian migrants from Lombardy, who started their aperitivo company in Argentina in 1880. The ad appeared in La Patria degli Italiani, the largest, most widely circulated Italian language daily in Argentina, on September 20th, 1905, and in addition, commemorating Italian unification in 1870. So the ad depicts a toga-clad woman representing Italia, the female embodiment of the Italian nation, with her arms around an oversized bottle of Pinerol. A city skyline floats behind her. Now in the right-hand corner, I know it's really hard to see from the back, but in the right-hand corner is an illustration of the candle factory in Staten Island in New York, where in the early 1850s, the exiled Italian nationalist leader, Giuseppe Garibaldi, worked for the Italian-American inventor, Antonio Meucci. The Pinerol ad sheds light on the very global context within which Italian migrants understood themselves as consumers in the early 20th century. So first, it shows how diasporic consumption linked Italian labor migrants in Argentina transnationally back to Italy. Garibaldi's own transatlantic peregrinations made him, of course, an especially symbolic vehicle. So known as the hero of two worlds, Garibaldi led the Italian Legion during post-independent civil wars that racked Latin American countries in the early 19th century. After his time in La Plata, Garibaldi then returned home to fight in the Italian Risorgimento. So in using Garibaldi as kind of a product endorser, the ad linked the histories of Argentine and Italian unification movements for consumers. Furthermore, Pinerol represented real trade connections between the two countries. So while manufactured in Argentina by Italian migrants, Pinerol itself was made from imported Italian ingredients, including Italian wine, almonds, saffron, orange, and lemon rinds. The ad, therefore, embodied the actual trade routes in Italian goods opened up by migrants like the Pini brothers and sustained by migrant demand for homeland tastes. Migratory and commercial flows together produced hybrid foods and beverages like Pinerol that reflected the transnational lives of migrant consumers. Finally, the Pinerol ad connected migrant consumers in Argentina not only back to Italy, but also to Italians in other parts of the Americas. The ad placed Garibaldi not in Latin America, notwithstanding his military reputation there, but in New York and to Meucci, another Italian nationalist sympathizer abroad. Italian migrant consumers in Buenos Aires, the ad suggested, were aware of Italian diasporas in other parts of the Americas, such as New York. So the mix of symbols, Italian, Argentine, US American, it reflected the complicated identities produced around food and beverages. So I wanted to begin with the Pinerol ad because it helps sort of introduce three kind of key takeaways or contributions or themes of my larger book project. So what I want to do tonight is tell you about the three kind of themes that I've chosen. And I'm going to mention them now and then kind of talk a little bit more about them in depth and provide some examples from the book project. So the first sort of major takeaway is that it's really critical, it's important to consider migration and trade together in histories of migrant consumption and global cuisines, and to recognize that migrant demand for homeland foods and tastes drove or guided transnational trade paths. My second kind of contribution is that I combine a transnational perspective that considers migrants' ongoing links to their homeland, in this case Italy, with a comparative perspective that takes into account how nation-specific differences shape migrant foodways. In this case, I'm looking at the US and Argentina. Finally, kind of the third theme of the book that I want to talk about today is a gendered one. So I trace the slow process through which migrant food consumption and the Italian identities that they helped forge went from being associated with mainly male labor migrants abroad in the late 19th century, to female migrants after World War I. So let me start with this sort of first takeaway, ties between migration and trade. So historic trade and migration statistics show that migrants did indeed create and sustain tangible formal networks of trade between Italy and the US and Argentina. So this figure here, it shows the percent of all Italian people and all Italian products headed to the Western Hemisphere that arrived in the US and Argentina from 1880 to 1940. So the US is in black, Argentina is in red, solid lines represent migrants, dotted lines represent Italian exports to these two countries. Well, there's a lot to be said about this graph. If we focus on just the black lines representing the United States and the red lines representing Argentina separately, we can see how the dynamics of export trade closely followed the dynamics of migration in both countries. With few exceptions, when Argentina's and the US's share of migrants increased, so too did countries' share of exports from Italy. So what this graph does not tell you is that many, if not most, of these trade items were foodstuff. So just to give you a snapshot, and I have it here from 1907, that year the US was the leading importer worldwide, not just to the Western Hemisphere, but worldwide, of Italian cheeses, pasta, tomato preserves, hazelnuts, lemons, and citrus extract, And Argentina was Italy's number one global importer of olive oil, wine, rice, vermouth, and spirits. That same year, Argentina and the U.S. together imported 75% of Italy's global exports of vermouth, 76% of Italy's bottled spirits, 60% of Italian tomato preserves, 44% of Italy's exported olive oil, 37% of Italian cheeses, and 34% of Italian wine. So this is really no surprise, since food served as the central commodity around which migrants really defined and redefined themselves as transnational people. So while the Italian government encouraged these real profitable connections between trade and migration, it was really on-the-ground migrant merchants and their consumers who preserved this transatlantic web of foods. Just to put a couple of faces to these trade statistics, let me introduce you real briefly to two merchants and their businesses. So one was the Sicilian Francesco Gianello, a former sea captain in the Merchant Marine and Italian Royal Navy. So from the store, and this is an image of his store, which he opened in 1891 in the heart of Buenos Aires' financial center, Gianello sold wines and cognacs, including Marsala dessert wine made by the Palermo-based winemaker Ivy Florio, as well as other sort of well-known wines like Martini and Rossi Vermouth. So one of Gianello's counterparts in New York was El Gandolfi and Company, established in New York City in 1883 by Luigi Gandolfi and Ettore Grassi from Lombardy. They sold a wide variety of Italian imported foods at their store in New York's Mulberry District, such as cheeses from Milan and Parma, olive oil from Lucca, dried pastas from Genoa and Naples, and well-known Italian liqueurs such as Fernet Branca Amaro and Florio Brand Marsala wine. So despite this colossal circulation of people and trade goods made possible by migrant merchants such as Gianello and Gandolfi and their consumers, and despite the importance of both migration and trade to the history of globalization, I found that scholars have been reluctant to study their connections and the consequences of these connections for identity formation, consumer practices, and sort of national and global foodways. Furthermore, a focus on migrants' sort of roles as international catalysts of trade, they tell us a really different story about globalization and about culinary globalization in particular, one driven just as much from below, that is by the movements of everyday people and their everyday food cultures, as from top-down processes initiated by business elites, politicians, and you know, more today, food conglomerates. So this focus on migration and trade, it led me to a framework that I hoped might be useful for scholars who were looking at other migrant groups at other in other time periods, and that framework is migrant marketplaces. So I define migrant marketplaces as urban spaces characterized by material and imagined transnational links between mobile people and mobile food. So the book in general, it argues that migrant marketplaces, cities like New York and Buenos Aires, they were global and they were gendered sites, and I'm gonna talk a little bit about gender in a bit, where Italians interacted with products from their home and host countries in ways that shaped migrants' identities and food practices, the consumer cultures in which they were enmeshed, and wider transatlantic commodity networks. Okay. So the second major question I sort of explored in my book was, how does combining a transnational framework that studies migrants' continuing ties to their home and a comparative perspective that considers nation-specific experiences, you know, how do these two perspectives together change our understanding of migration and food history? Well, you know, first, just at its most basic, it reminds us that the U.S. was not the only nation of immigrants. So yes, during the age of kind of mass migration, the U.S. received more migrants than any other nation or territory, but many migrants went other places as well, often to nations like Argentina, Canada, and Australia, that also came to consider themselves in some ways nations of immigrants. So combining a transnational and a comparative perspective, it encourages a truly sort of global perspective or approach that simply cannot be done in studies that consider only one nation exclusively. And I'll add here too that the Italian language press in Buenos Aires and New York really sort of made the study of migrant marketplaces possible, in part because they ground these migratory and commercial flows in specific cities, reminding us that these sort of global or transnational processes, they take shape in and depend on localized social relations. So, but just to return one more time to these trade and migration statistics, it made sense for me to focus on the US and Argentina as one analytical site. So these two countries together received the majority of overseas Italian migrants and trade products during the age of mass migration, which is why, in part, I chose to write on these two countries and New York and Argentina, since they, New York and Buenos Aires, since they served as sort of the principal gateways for Italian migrants and trade goods entering the Americas from the North and South Atlantic. Furthermore, as you can kind of see from these graphs, increases in the percent of exports and migrants to one country almost always meant a decrease in exports and migrants to the other. So a dynamic that's better seen when we look at migration and trade separately, which we can see in these graphs. Okay, the top shows migrants to the US and Argentina. Okay, the bottom shows exports to the US and Argentina. So this is reflected in the way that lines for people and products in the two countries, they appear almost as exact mere opposites of each other. So when the share of Italian exports to the US went up, for example, the share of Argentina's usually went down. Okay, this sort of pattern is seen most poignantly probably in the 1920s. And you can see this looking at the top graph here. So in the 1920s, when restrictive immigration legislation passed in the US, it reversed the historic dominance of the US over Argentina as the larger receiver of Italian immigrants. So Italians responded to US immigration policy by going south to Argentina. And you can kind of see that in the top graph here. So a comparative perspective shows that while we see how migrants in both countries, in both the US and Argentina, form their consumer identities and practices around goods from Italy, nation-specific differences in the US and Argentina, migration legislation, trade and tariff policies, economic, industrial, social, political, and cultural terrains, and ethno-racial landscapes, they created different opportunities for eaters in these two locations. So let me give you an example. So while much of my book focuses on imported Italian foodstuff, migrants combined these imported products and culinary traditions with new ingredients, new dishes, new culinary practices in their host country. So yes, migrants clung to regional gastronomic customs from back home, seeing in them symbols of comfort and stability, as well as really the material means for solidifying family bonds and communal identities. But poor Italian day laborers found in the Americas new, cheaper, and usually more abundant ingredients, especially meat, which they then incorporated into traditional dishes, creating new, more varied, nutritious iterations of what they had been eating back in Italy. In fact, migrants, starting in the late 1800s, they first began producing the foods that would become increasingly problematic to Italian importers or merchants. Foods that I call, and what migrants called themselves, tipo italiano goods. So Italian style, pasta, liquors, wine, cigar and cigarettes, canned fruit and vegetables, including tomato preserves, candies, cheese, cured meats, all made in the US and Argentina by Italian migrants. So already by the late 19th century, these savvy Italian migrant entrepreneurs, food industrialists, farmers, grocery store owners, restaurateurs, street vendors, they capitalized on economic, technological, and agricultural resources abroad to produce these Italian-style foods, mainly for migrants, at least at first. So these tipo italiano foods, they came to compete with imported products. And they actually unleashed a wave of debates over the consequences of links between migration and trade and over meanings of authenticity, nationality in migrant marketplaces. Okay, so what explained the success of these tipo italiano industries in the US and Argentina? The burgeoning number of these foods was an outcome of the increasingly kind of globalized world in which workers labored and consumed in countries thousands of miles away from their homelands. So migrant food entrepreneurs, they responded to the labor and the consumer needs and food cravings of Italians and their descendants by employing food knowledge, expertise, and workers from Italy, but using resources abroad in the US and Argentina. So in both countries, Italian migrants, for example, they took advantage of agricultural products in the US and Argentina, raw ingredients that were found in some of Italy's most profitable exports, like tomatoes or grapes or wheat, which could often be produced in larger quantities and at cheaper prices abroad. They also capitalized on migrants' employment needs by securing Italian workers, migrant workers, in many of their food businesses. Okay, also, these tipo italiano foods, they're almost always cheaper than imported foods, satisfying working class migrants' simultaneous desire to nourish themselves with these homeland foods, but also to save money, to be able to save money to send home back to Italy. So the comparative approach I employed, however, sort of revealed some important differences in the way that tipo italiano foods developed in the US and Argentina. So in the US, migrant entrepreneurs took advantage of the US's more robust industrial capacities and protectionist economic policies to produce and popularize a wider variety and greater quantity of tipo italiano foods than migrants did in Argentina. So this is an ad for Ernesto Bisi's United States Macaroni Factory in Carnegie, Pennsylvania. So associating his product with industrial modernity, Bisi advertised his factory as, quote, the most perfect, the most modern, and among the largest that exist in the United States. He employed a diverse set of symbols that really reflected the transnational world in which his migrant consumers lived. We see a large illustration of the Statue of Liberty. It ties the tipo italiano food to a US emblem of freedom and migration. That BC produced pasta by the, quote, carload for buyers, not just in the US, but also Canada and Mexico, and presented his establishment as a, quote, emporium of foodstuff. It hints at the industrial resources that were available to him in the US, but inaccessible to migrants in Argentina. So BC and other migrant producers of tipo italiano foods, they exploited the US's more mature manufacturing sector and more protective economic policies and food safety legislation to produce, market, and distribute their domestically produced foods on a mass scale. So already by the turn of the 20th century, food was the US's foremost manufacturing sector. And migrants in the US benefited from an extensive and sturdy industrial infrastructure, robust transportation networks, a growing advertising and marketing industry, a large and expanding consumer base, in part due to migration to the United States, and national and international distribution networks. Migrants in Argentina didn't have access to the same range of industrial capacities, technological resources, and financial networks. There, businesses continued to rely on imports, in part because Argentina's food businesses and businesses in general were slower to mechanize. So with some important exceptions, tipo italiano industries in Argentina, they remained relatively small scale before World War I. So pasta production is probably the best example of this. Okay, the great demand for pasta among the US, among the US's Italian population, it really kind of fueled the wildfire-like growth of pasta factories around the country. So by 1906, just in greater New York alone, there were more than a dozen large-scale pasta factories employing over 2 million workers. In Argentina, obstacles and limitations embedded in the country's weaker industrial base and consumer market, it kept most pasta establishments small or modest before World War I. Demand for pasta outstripped local production in Argentina. ensuing a continued market for pasta imports. So in 1909, the value of Italian pasta imports to the U.S. was almost 150 times greater than the value of such exports to Argentina. But then just 6 years later, in 1915, in large part due to the U.S.'s now sort of massive tipo Italiano pasta industry, the value of pasta exports to the U.S. had decreased by almost half, while imports to Argentina continued to rise. So in 1916, Italy exported almost four times more pasta to Argentina than to the United States. So in Argentina's less industrial mature business environment, tipo Italiano became associated not so much with domestically made alternatives to Italian imports, but with products originating outside of Argentina. So cultural similarities, including similarities in the food cultures of Italy and other sort of Mediterranean nations such as Spain, France, and Greece, allowed entrepreneurs in both Argentina and Europe to pass off their exported foods as Italian. So these similarities in food cultures are in part rooted in Spain's long-standing presence in the Italian peninsula during the medieval and early modern period, and Spanish colonization of the Americas, much of it done, of course, by merchants and sailors from Italy's northern city-states. So already by the 17th century, Spain and Portugal had introduced these sort of new world foods such as tomatoes, potatoes, corn, chili, peppers to Italy, eventually manifesting in typical regional dishes like polenta, potato gnocchi, and the tomato and pepper-based sauces, stews, and condiments by the time of mass Italian emigration. So these early modern Atlantic circulations of food and culinary knowledge between Europe, particularly Spain and Italy, but other countries along the Mediterranean, and what was then the viceroyalty of the Rio de la Plata, Argentina, it did create some overlap in the cuisines of these countries as they evolved over the next three centuries. So this cultural and kind of culinary overlap, it allowed kind of Latin countries in Europe to also exploit the large Latin migrant consumer market in Argentina by passing their products off as or comparing their products to genuine Italian imports. Italian preserved fish, canned vegetables and fruit, wines and spirits, they found fierce competition in Argentina in comparable products from Spain and France. Cheese from Switzerland rivaled Italian cheeses in flavor and in cost. Italy and Germany competed to be Argentina's number one supplier of rice, and Portugal did the same with their exports of dried fruit. Olive oil from Tunisia and Spain was being erroneously labeled as Italian in Argentina. So whereas in New York, Italian migrant importers, they really sort of lashed out at tipo Italiano foods that were made in New York's migrant marketplaces, their counterparts down in Argentina, they instead really sort of focused their ire at these tipo Italiano foods originating outside of Buenos Aires' migrant marketplaces, from Italy's European competitors, especially Spain and France. In the US, conversely, many political leaders really viewed their country's heritage as tied to Anglo-Saxon and Nordic settlers in ways that marginalized the role that Latin colonization had played in the nation's history. In middle-class Anglo-American culinary nationalists, they were reaching back to this imagined sort of New England cuisine with its roots in Northern Europe for what it meant to eat and to be U.S. American. There were fewer exchanges between Anglo-Americans and Italians around food in the U.S. in the early 20th century than there were between Italians and Argentines, making Buenos Aires' migrant marketplaces much more porous sites where both Argentines and Italians both kind of bought and ate Italian food and tipo Italiano food. So looking at the differences in tipo Italiano industries, it makes clear how economic, political, and the ethno-racial structures of the US and Argentina generated distinct or different experiences and identities around foodstuff. Okay. And before kind of moving on to like the last takeaway that I wanted to talk about, I did want to add here that combining a transnational and a comparative perspective, it also exposes north-south hemispheric connections between migrant marketplaces of the Americas. connections fostered in large part through the U.S.'s increasing presence in Latin America over the 20th century. So what I found is that migrant marketplaces in New York and Buenos Aires, they became increasingly linked together after World War I, not so much due to the circulation of Italian migrants and foods from New York to Buenos Aires and Buenos Aires to New York, but due to U.S. food conglomerates. So already in the early 20th century, these U.S. food businesses had started targeting Italian migrants in the U.S. as consumers of their foods. And they targeted them specifically as migrants, rather than as sort of Anglo-Americans. They did that by advertising in the Italian language press, by advertising in Italian, and by often referring to Italian culinary traditions. But by the late 1920s, we see some of these same U.S. food businesses beginning to target Italians in Argentina as well. This is due, you know, to a confluence of factors. So U.S. business interests started turning away from Europe's already saturated market and towards countries in Latin America and Asia for consumers and sites of capital investment and cheap labor. During and after World War I, Europe, especially England, retracted many of its investments in Latin America, kind of creating an opening for U.S. business influence. And importantly, U.S. immigration restriction radically reduced the number of migrants, including Italians, from entering the U.S. And migration statistics show, and I'd showed you before here, they showed that Italians responded to discriminatory policies in the U.S. by heading to Argentina, which left its doors relatively open to migrants through the 30s. So U.S. corporations that had worked so hard to target migrants in the U.S. as food consumers, they literally saw their markets head south to Argentina. So just as a quick example, these are two advertisements for the Chicago-based meatpacking plant, Armour and Company. Okay, in this 1937 ad in New York's Il Progresso, it's this one here, an older woman displays a platter of sliced La Stella brand prosciutto. And she testifies in Italian, "When I serve Armour prosciutto, I know that dinner will be a great success. La Stella Armour has that delicious taste, that fragrance, that aroma characteristic of the old country that Italians love so much." So starting in the 1920s, U.S. business food businesses like Armour had discovered Italians as a consumer bloc, and they tried to reach them by advertising in the migrant press, by advertising often in Italian, and by associating their products with Italianità, or Italianness. Soon after, some of these same companies transferred their sort of experience or expertise targeting migrants in the U.S. to Argentina. So this other ad here for Armour's Genoa-style tripe, well, it is in Spanish. It appeared in Buenos Aires' Italian language newspaper, Il Mattino d'Italia. It, too, stressed the Italianness of its product. So the ad featured an illustration of medieval Genoa and a text that began, "The Genoese, who today are many in this welcoming land, brought us something other than their proverbial industriousness and aptitude for work. They also brought their flavorful regional dishes and, of course, the most exquisite of all, Genoese-style tripe that now Armour gives you ready to serve." So increasingly, as U.S. companies turn their attention to Argentina in other Latin American countries, I found some of the same industrialized foodstuff made by U.S. businesses linking migrant marketplaces in Buenos Aires and New York. So this comparative and transnational perspective brought up for me really interesting questions about the role migrant consumers and laborers played in the history of U.S. imperial projects in Latin America, and the way migrant consumption and foodways shaped and were shaped by U.S. incursions in Latin America in the 20th century. So the migrant marketplaces of New York and Buenos Aires, they were connected not only by U.S. food industrialists like Armour, or through the transnational connections that both cities maintained with Italy, but also through gender, which brings me to the kind of final theme that I want to talk about tonight. So gender does not figure centrally in narratives of the history of migrant entrepreneurship or global capitalism, even though ideas about masculinity and femininity intersected with nationality and ethnicity to influence the formation of migratory and commodity markets. So I was curious about the role gender played in the formation or establishment of migrant marketplaces. And what I found is that over the course of the 20th century, migrant marketplaces in both countries feminized as Italian food businesses and exporters, World War I, tariffs, immigration restriction, and demographic changes slowly shifted ties between food consumption and Italianness from single male laborers to female consumers and families. So let me kind of unpack that a little further using some examples. So in the late 19th and early 20th centuries, elite representations of Italian people in food exports and trademarks and in the migrant press, they masculinized migrant marketplaces and the transnational paths in which they were embedded. So such imagery and discussion highlighted almost exclusively Italian industrial production, cultural superiority, military dominance, and images of elite Italian men. So many trademarks portrayed Italian royalty, military, religious, and cultural leaders as, again, kind of product endorsers, connecting migrants' purchases to the consumer habits of Italian notables, Italian kings, as well as Italian well-known Italian migrants such as Garibaldi and especially Christopher Columbus. So Italian companies and merchants, they regularly paired these portraits of Italian male personas to illustrations of Italian industrial accomplishments, often represented in factories, steamships, and railroads, to project positive ideas about the quality and promise of Italy and its exports and emigrants. So to show one example, this is a trademark for Garofalo's pasta factory from 1905. Okay, we have here again Italia balancing a shield with the red and white crest of the House of Savoy, while overlooking the modern smoke-billowing factory, pasta factory near Naples. At the bottom of the trademark, you can see a series of medallions here featuring almost identical looking whiskered leaders or busts of Italian whiskered leaders. So one pictures Vittorio Emanuele II, the first king of a united Italy and an emblem of the Risorgimento. The other two are less recognizable figures, although one labored emperor suggests links between Garofalo and the legacy of Imperial Rome, while the other medallions of the merchant marine in Naples, I know it's hard for you guys to see that back there, tied the product to Italy's contemporary commercial fleet. The intertwined U.S. and Italian flags in the lower corner here, along with the writing in English, symbolize transatlantic routes between producers in Italy and consumers in the United States. So these overwhelmingly masculine representations match the language used by Italian notables who hoped to utilize male emigrants abroad as vehicles of nation and empire building. And they did so in part because Italian migration remained overwhelmingly male, particularly for the years before World War I. Unlike neighboring European countries where ties between consumption and nationhood were increasingly associated with women, Italy's massive male migration, massive migration, required linking Italian consumption to male citizens abroad. So these male-centered sort of descriptions projected, you know, confident messages about Italy as a great European power and an expansionist country, one that could vie with other industrialized nations. And this was especially critical for Italy as it struggled to maintain international standing amidst failed colonial adventures in East Africa, regional divisiveness, peasant revolts, socialist uprisings, and a lagging industrial and economic landscape. These manly images offered a rebuttal to the sometimes feminized language used by Italy's European competitors to describe the country's people, culture, and country. A young Italy, for example, of emasculated and powerless children, or an effeminate country with un popolo donna, a womanly people. So these manly migrant marketplaces, however, they began to feminize in the early 20th century as family reunification policies, immigration restriction, a growing gender-balanced second generation of Italians born abroad, and ties between femininity and consumption globally increasingly linked Italian women to Italian food and Italianità, or Italianness. So World War I, I found, was a real kind of key turning point. Migrant women's involvement in transnational wartime campaigns to help their homeland in need increasingly normalized consumption as a duty to their homeland in need, while fostering the growth of a more united Italian identity among migrants. So many migrant women's war-related activities, many of which revolved around buying and saving food and providing food to Italian soldiers back in Italy and to families in the Americas left behind by their recalled male relatives that went back to Italy to fight. Okay, these transnational fundraising campaigns, they really launched migrant women into the Italian-American or Italian language press and created an opening for increased acceptance of migrant consumption associated with women after the war. And Italian companies and merchants, they capitalized on this increasingly powerful linkage between women, consumption, and Italianità after the war by portraying women as the principal buyers of Italian food imports. So let me give you two examples. So during the interwar years, migrant marketplaces, they feminized as advertisements and discussion about Italian food, as well as the transnational identities that they generated, became increasingly moored to women, consumption, and families, rather than to men in production. So ads in the migrant press, they often featured women and families enjoying Italian food in private settings, such as the home. So rather than highlighting Italy's production capacities, as did 19th century trademarks, ads after World War I instead emphasized the importance of Italians, usually women, on the consumption end of the commodity chain, using products to link migrant households back to Italy and to reproduce Italian identities and culinary traditions abroad. This 1925 ad for Cheerio brand canned tomatoes in Argentina's La Patria, it basically shuffled viewers along the entire transatlantic commodity circuit. So beginning with tomatoes from the, quote, best lands in Italy, and ending around a dinner table where families, quote, enjoy perfect health because they always use Cheerio brand tomato extract. So this shift towards consumption brought more women into ads as buyers and consumers of Italian goods. Okay, another example is an advertisement that made the cover of the book, and again, it's from Argentina's La Patria. Through her individual consumer preferences, Italian women, such as the ones portrayed in the Sasso olive oil ad, connected migrant women's everyday purchases, often represented as integral to the maintenance of Italian family traditions in the private domestic realm, to the very public sphere of transnational trade. So publicity for and discussion about Italian products in the 1920s and 1930s, as well as the identities that they generated, became increasingly anchored simultaneously to consumption and to women. The feminization of migrant marketplaces became particularly politicized with the rise of fascism in Italy, when Benito Mussolini's fascist government endeavored to fortify Italy's relationship with its migrants abroad. During the 1930s, Mussolini and his supporters abroad, they sought to capitalize on migrant consumption, especially in 1935 and 1936, when the League of Nations placed economic sanctions on Italy in response to Italy's invasion of Ethiopia. So during that boycott, that economic sanction, Mussolini really hoped migrant consumption of Italian products would compensate for the decrease in Italian trade to the 58 member countries in the League of Nations. At the same time, however, Mussolini attempted to disassociate Italian consumption, both in Italy and in migrant marketplaces abroad, from US-style consumption and US-style or Western-style femininity. So as part of Mussolini's nationalist economic policies, the fascist state tried to control and direct women's consumption, promoting simple diets with no or little meat, no or little imported ingredients, celebrating Italian women's thriftiness and sobriety, and critiquing female consumers in the US and Western Europe as immorally materialistic, greedily individualistic, and insalubriously skinny, instead advancing a fascist model of womanhood, a wholesome, fecund, full-figured, and eager to really procreate for the state. So ironically, as Mussolini tried to divorce Italian women from Western-style consumption at home, Italian language newspapers abroad, supported economically by Italian fascists, employed links between women and foodstuff to generate Italian identities. So as a final example, this is a 1936 ad for San Pellegrino sparkling water, and it appeared in Il Mattino d'Italia. This was a pro-Mussolini Italian language newspaper in Argentina. The ad depicted a scene from a festive costume ball. A woman in the foreground who was adjusting her mask clearly partied too hard, the ad implied, and so she required immediate digestive relief. Behind her, couples kind of danced festively with balloons or beneath balloons. So the ad says, after the party, if you ate or drank too much, regulate your digestive system by drinking San Pellegrino. So while the ad, appearing in a pro-Mussolini migrant newspaper, portrayed overindulgent food and beverage consumption tying migrant consumers to Italian imports, in Italy, Mussolini was condemning displays of decadence and overindulgent consumption suggested in the ad, and demanded instead that Italians, women in particular, really subordinate their consumer desires to the needs of the autarkic state. Furthermore, by the 1930s, migrants had formed identities and experiences not only around Italian imported foods, but around US and Argentine foods. And Italians' buying and eating practices, while yes, still remained very much kind of tied to products and traditions from back home, had become less fixed to notions of duty to la patria as they had during World War I. So by the 1930s, Italy, the US, and Argentina, they were all competing for the attention of consumers, especially women in migrant marketplaces. So just to conclude, when we, I think, discuss the globalization of cuisines, I think it's really important to remember that foods and culinary cultures, they don't just simply diffuse or spread across the world, but rather food is very much connected to mobile people and to time and place-specific political, legal, and economic policies that allow for or discourage such mobility. So it was Italian migrants' expectations, their initiatives, their desires that really drove histories of trade and ultimately sort of the globalization of Italian food today. So I'll stop there. Thank you.
Incredible talk, amazing. Can you talk a little bit about the relationship between advertising and consumption? I mean, is it easy to tell whether ads are affecting consumption or consumption is, you know, driving the market? I guess I'm thinking about the Argentine ads that you showed. Mm-hmm. I think we want to imagine that conglomerates are taking advantage of people or telling them what they want, but is it easy to tell whether the market was driving the ads or the ads were driving the market?
Yeah, it's a great question. And ads obviously tell us only so much. And I think that's why it's really important to kind of contextualize ads and your analysis of ads sort of in the larger, like, historical milieu. So yes, when we study ads and advertising, we never know how a consumer or how a reader is going to receive or respond to a advertisement. But I tried to get around some of those issues by thinking, like, I chose specifically the two largest circulating popular Italian language newspapers in the US and Argentina. I had circulation figures for both those papers, which helps a little bit with sort of determining how many people were seeing these ads. But ultimately, I think advertisements, even if we can't know how people are responding to them, whether they actually caused an Italian migrant to go buy Sasso brand olive oil, I still think they tell us something interesting kind of about kind of discursive or kind of representations of links between Italian trade and migration. So I tried in my book to kind of make that clear, that there are obviously, you know, limitations to studying ads such as that. But, you know, I think, again, I tried to kind of embed the advertisements in, like, larger discussions about migrant consumption, about migrant communities in these two locations, to try to give us a sense of the kind of cultures and communities that created or were responding possibly to these ads. So I don't know if that answers your question all that well, but it's a good one.
Some of the images you showed were from trademarks, and then some were ads. So did they use the same imagery in both? I mean, did they have advertising agencies? I mean, they did, obviously, here and in Argentina. They would just take the image that the company was trying to put forth about masculine, whatever, strength and production and so forth, and they would use those as inducements to buy?
Yeah, another good question. So some of the trademarks that I found in the Italian State Archives, and it was just incredible. The Italian State Archives in Rome have this collection of trademarks. So I was focusing on trademarks that were produced, and at this time, most of them were the late 19th, early 20th century. And advertising historians have sort of noted that some of these earlier trademarks were produced by companies themselves. They would often hire an artist, but there wasn't really the type of advertising agencies that we saw a little bit later on. So sometimes those actual trademarks then I'd see in the Italian language press, which was really, really kind of cool to be able to actually see those connections. But they're certainly two different mediums in many cases. So trademarks were appearing more so on the actual product itself. So if, you know, pasta was exported in a big crate, you would see the trademark actually on the crate itself. But there are some times where there's overlap and you see the trademarks actually merge in the migrant press, but they certainly are sort of two different kind of commercial iconographies.
I'm curious whether any of these companies, and I'm thinking about actually the advertisement from Armor Meatpacking in particular, you know, to what extent they relied on intermediaries to even kind of understand or grasp the sort of psychology of the immigration experience, right? Because I know this is also the era where people are obsessing over theories around nostalgia and what it means to, you know, be removed from your culture. And so, you know, when a company like Armor is producing those advertisements that, you know, went to both Argentina and the US, you know, are they hiring, you know, Italian language speakers? Are they contemplating kind of what sentiments can really bring in consumers?
Yeah. One of the like aha moments for me when it came to this research was working with an archive, the J. Walter Thompson archive. So J. Walter Thompson was sort of the largest and first advertising agency in the United States and globally. And they actually had a lot of businesses in Argentina as well that they did marketing and advertising for. But I found this like just amazing sort of archival gem when I came across these internal memos circulated amongst the advertising people at J. Walter Thompson that indicated that they had started reading the Italian language press and other migrant newspapers. And they had sort of discovered in the early 1920s, right after, you know, World War I, they, you know, they are consciously looking to kind of exploit or target migrant consumers. And they themselves are going to the Italian language press. So there is this whole maybe 6 months worth of newsletters produced by this advertising firm that talks about all these different migrant communities as consumer markets. And so I don't know if they were actually consulting with actual migrants to kind of capitalize on nostalgia to get information from them. But I did find it interesting that they too, that US advertising firms And J. Walter Thompson actually did advertising work for Armour, for example, had sort of discovered the migrant press and were seen in the migrant press like hints, I guess, for thinking about them as ethnic consumers, not just as, you know, consumers, or, you know, not thinking of the market as just this homogenous mass, but rather consumers having like distinct needs and backgrounds and preferences and things like that. But thanks.
Thanks for this great talk, Liz. I wanted to know if you could talk a little bit more about trends you observed in the advertisements about language. I know that a lot of the newspapers you're looking at are specifically Italian language newspapers, but I'm curious, and this may not be the case, if you see changes over time in either more use of English or Spanish is one more prevalent, or did that change happen at a different speed in Argentina versus the US, or are they really relying on pictures rather than written complex advertisements?
One point that I argue in the book is I try to argue that migrant marketplaces in Buenos Aires were much more permeable and porous, that they invited both Argentines and Italians, and that identities and consumer experiences really helped kind of forge these bonds and consumer experiences for Argentines and Italians in particular. And one of the kind of reasons I argue that is looking at the press, both the Italian language press in Argentina, but then the mainstream Spanish language Argentine press. And what I found a couple of things. First of all, Italian importers were advertising their goods, so Italian olive oil, in Spanish and Italian in the Spanish press, so in the Argentine press. But then also a lot of the advertisements for imported Italian foods in the Italian language press were in Spanish, and at a very early time. So already in the early 20th century, we see a lot of Spanish in Italian language newspapers. And of course, the linguistic similarities between Spanish and Italian explain that in part. But in the book, I kind of talk about other similarities between Italians and Argentines, religious, linguistic, cultural, that really allow for Argentines and Italians to use food as a way to kind of create community and a shared culture of consumption. But in the US, conversely, we don't see English language advertisements in Il Progresso, so New York's main Italian language press, until much later, till after World War I. It's something that I found really interesting, is that there was so much almost code switching in Argentina. Spanish and Italian were used in very much together, and in some cases in the same ad. You know, you'd have Italian and Spanish. So, yeah.
Is it correct that the early immigrants to Argentina were more from northern Italy? Did you notice that playing a role in what you saw in Argentina versus the U.S.?
It's something, of course, that I note in the book. So
yeah.
Migration to Argentina happened earlier than mass migration to the United States, and they tended to come from more northern regions, especially at first. And also, there were slightly more sort of skilled laborers that headed to Argentina rather than to the United States. But what I did find is that Italians in Argentina, it doesn't really have so much to do with regional kind of differences, but because Italians had arrived in Argentina earlier, and because Italians made up a really large percent of the total foreign-born population in Argentina, that played a big role in creating these differences. So around 1890, Italians made up about 60% of the total foreign-born population in Argentina. At the same time, Italians made up only 6% of the foreign-born population in the United States. And so Italians in Argentina really came to just dominate. They dominated basically middle-class merchant positions. While, of course, there were many manual laborers, a lot of them sort of dominated the food businesses that both, of course, Argentines and Italians and other migrants to Argentina were frequenting. So that too kind of gave, there was a demographic advantage, I guess, that Italian migrants had in Argentina that they didn't have in the United States. So, yeah.
Very interesting speech and a talk this evening. Presenting the newspaper advertisements assumes that the population was literate. Mm-hmm. Did you have percentages of both the literacy in the U.S. and in Argentina?
I don't know percentages, but I mean, you're very right. I mean, we're talking about a migration of mainly working class laborers, many illiterate. In terms of I write a lot about the prominenti, sort of the prominent leaders of the Italian migrant communities in the U.S. and Argentina, those that were really in charge of the food establishments, particularly merchants, right? So the Italian press, obviously, yeah, it's very dominated by, especially the mainstream commercial press, is dominated by prominent, you know, middle-class Italian leaders. So, I mean, that's another really good point to bring up, is that there are limits to being able to kind of explore who's reading and seeing these advertisements. One of the reasons I like the visuals is that at least I can imagine that even illiterate migrants are able to understand, I guess, the advertisements in a visual way. But, you know, it's a good question. I talk in the book about how, you know, by World War I and afterwards, that literacy rates are rising among migrants, and of course, especially among that second generation. And so we see the ethnic press in Argentina and the U.S. really sort of reaching out and trying to make sure they hold on to that second generation of Italians who are literate, who, you know, are increasingly, you know, educated. And I kind of can see that in the press as they're really trying to reach out and hold on to those second generation migrants. But it's a good question.
If there are no more questions, then please join me in thanking Elizabeth Zanoni once again.
Thank you. Thanks to everyone for being here.